Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our council meeting today, Tuesday the 25th of July 2023. I'll declare the meeting open at 6:30 p.m. Welcome to those of you in the gallery tonight, and for those of you watching online at home, welcome councillors and officers. To commence today, item 1.1, the acknowledgement of country, Councillor Dixon. Thank you.
Thank you. Mornington Peninsula Shire acknowledges the Bunurong people who have been the custodians of this land for many thousands of years and pays respects to their elders past and present. We acknowledge that the land on which we meet is the place of age-old ceremonies, celebrations, initiation and renewal, and that the Bunurong people's living culture continues to have a unique role in the life of this region.
Thank you, Councillor Dixon. We proceed to procedural matters, section 2 of our agenda, item 2.1, apologies. Are there any apologies? None this evening. Item 2.2, disclosures of conflicts of interest. Are there any disclosures, councillors? No disclosures. Item 2.3, confirmation of minutes. Councillors, there's a recommendation before us. Does any councillor wish to move a motion to that effect or otherwise? Councillor Brooks? A seconder, Councillor O'Connor. Any opposition? I'll put the matter to the vote. All those in favour? Carried unanimously. Item 2.4, Council Decision Register. Likewise, councillors, there is an officer recommendation before us. I'm seeking a mover. Councillor Chelly. Is there a seconder? Councillor Maher. Any opposition? Do you wish to be heard? In that case, I'll put the matter to the vote. All those in favour? Against? Yes, motion carried. Councillor Gill's opposition is noted. Thank you, councillors. Item 2.5 is public question time. I believe we have three questions this evening without notice. I'll hand over to the Chief Executive Officer, Mr. John Baker.
Thank you, Mayor. And through you, yes, three questions this evening. And the first one is from a Mr. Lees, a resident of Flinders, and he's asked the following question, in fact, two questions. They were received late, so actually we'll be taking these on notice and they'll receive a written response. Flinders Community Association and local groups are planning large community events in Flinders in 2024. When can we have booking dates and costing surety to hire the new Flinders Civic Hall? Budgeting is impossible without costing clarity. Booking, entertainment, entertainers, catering and additional AV plus accommodation bookings are impossible without certainty of dates and costs. So they say we'll send a written response in answer to that question. The next one, also from Mr. Lees, is on visitor paid parking, the pilot. Council advised it will consult during the paid parking pilot but doesn't explain the lack of consultation before the decision was made. Why has it taken so long to answer questions submitted by many online before the pilot is implemented? The pilot will not resolve parking problems across the peninsula. We urge council to reconsider and cancel the pilot at Flinders. The next question is from Mr. Ahrens, a resident of Flinders, and he's asked the following question. Given that the proposed visitor-paid parking pilot solves none of the peak-time parking problems in Flinders, why would such a pilot be considered before the commitments for traffic and usage studies are carried out? The same applies to all our coastal towns. Don't these major parking problems need solving before any visitor-paid parking is considered? As I said, there'll be a written response sent out to those people. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Baker. That concludes procedural items. We now move to Section 3, Councillors and Delegates' Reports, Item 3.1. Councillor Race, you have two reports this evening.
Thank you. I just wanted to report on a couple of activities I've done recently. There's been a bit of chatter in the, I guess, around the traps about what councillors get up to and what their role is, and I want to kind of relate some of the breadth of our role. So during the school holidays, I had the privilege of attending the Global Symposium for Hot Springs, hosted by Peninsula Hot Springs. It was a really insightful event. I learned a lot about the industry, which is now one of the major tourism attractions on the peninsula and globally. One of the top five reasons people travel to Australia is for hot springs. Great to see local education provider Chisholm Institute represented and hear about their collaboration with the Peninsula Hot Springs on the Diploma of Hydrothermal Wellness, which will actually be rolled out across Victoria. And the proposal for a planner's guide to hot springs development. Currently, there isn't a designation for hot springs in the Victorian planning provisions and planning provisions generally. And I got to meet people from China, New Zealand and the USA who had all come to talk things hot springs, as well as members from our local and state tourism bodies. And then this afternoon, I had the most wonderful event. I attended the Christmas in July with some of my favourite people, the Tukgaruk seniors. They're an incredibly vibrant and active bunch with nearly 300 members. We enjoyed a delicious lunch with live music from the Neely brothers, dancing and great conversations. Definitely a great day at the councillor office. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Race. And a report from Councillor Gill.
Thank you. Mine's a bit disjointed because it's come to me in that way, but I'll battle through it. It's from the AAA Housing Committee and Advisory Committee and Council Officers. And it's about Homelessness Week coming up from the 6th to the 12th of August. There's a walk rally, which is now confirmed for 4 p.m. on Friday, the 11th of August, and all are welcome to come along to that. I think, I'm not sure of the actual address because it's not here, but it's in Rosebud. Village Green, thank you. That's why it's a little disjointed, sorry. I believe the Deputy Mayor will be speaking. Thank you. There's also a postcard for Homelessness Week and other homelessness activities are happening. Balnarring will be the first who will be having a barbecue in the shopping centre, supported by local church and the Bendigo Bank and Lions who are cooking. And many people will be collecting your money. So anyone who turns up, that will be probably followed by several others in Flinders and Hastings, but not on the same day. We're providing a lot more information will be coming out next week about that. The Southern Homelessness Support Services Network are delivering a Houses of Parliament campaign. It's about encouraging people to make origami paper houses to be displayed on the 2nd of August on the steps of Parliament House to represent the number of homeless people on the peninsula. We're also attending, council's attending Queen's Hall for 2 days. I thought it was 3 days, but on the Wednesday, I think most councillors will be in Queen's Hall. And we'll be presenting some of the of our advocacy to politicians, and one of the main issues will be homelessness on the peninsula. In further good news, we have supported Vinnie's to return to takeaway service 11:30 to 12:30 each day from the 31st of July. So that was out of action. Everyone's probably read about what happened there with some upsets, but that's coming back. And we've supported them by training for all of their volunteers in the issues that did arise. No fault of their own. And a new survey window and some updated building safety enhancements will be included. That's all I can really report on at the moment. But at Homelessness Week, we all know the problems. And hopefully we can make some inroads into the issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. Are there any other reports tonight? No? All right, that concludes section 3 of our agenda. We now move to section 4, management reports. First of all, planning and infrastructure, item 4.1, which is planning application P21/1547, 3A to 5 Bay Road, Mount Martha. Councillors, tonight we have two submitters to hear from. The applicant and the objector, and one objector, Mr. Robert Williams, if you could come forward, please. We've got a seat up at the table. Councillor Roper and Bissinger, if you could just make sure the microphone's on. Mr. Williams, after you'll have 3 minutes to speak, And after you've spoken, are you happy to take questions from councillors?
I am. Yes.
Thank you for that. All right, we'll start the clock when you start speaking. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, councillors. My name is Robert Williams. I'm an associate planner at Human Habitats. We represent the permit applicant for this proposed cafe and restaurant extension at 3A to 5 Bay Road, Mount Martha. We agree with council planning's the council's planning department, their assessment that the proposal is appropriate. It will be a positive contribution to Mount Martha and should be supported. Noting that the use of a cafe and restaurant does not require planning permission, we believe the application has appropriately addressed the relevant considerations, these being the proposed extension of the building, the car parking reduction, the liquor license, and potential noise impacts. The plans and 3D renders submitted demonstrate that the proposed extension will sit comfortably within the Bay Road streetscape through retaining the ground floor footprint and parapet, with the upper level and roof terrace set back behind. Similar materials and finishes are proposed to complement and integrate the extension with the existing brick ground floor group of shops. The traffic report provided confirms that the proposed car parking reduction is appropriate. Council's traffic department is also supportive of the proposal, with a maximum of 20 patrons before 5 p.m. and 60 patrons after 5 p.m. Two bicycle spaces are also provided to encourage active transport and reduce car use. The proposed liquor license is part of the cafe and restaurant operation and a typical offering of food and drink premises. There are other licensed venues in the area, however, due to the limited number of patrons for the proposal and the range of closing times of the other licensed venues, as confirmed by council planning, there will not be a detrimental cumulative impact on the area. Victoria Police has also reviewed the proposal and has no concerns relating to liquor, only potential noise. And in terms of noise, the potential impact of the site on the residential area to the south has been considered. The acoustic assessment provided confirms that there will be no detrimental noise impacts through incorporation of glass balustrades along the front of the balcony and around the roof terrace. Patron numbers will also be limited to a maximum of 20 and 40 people respectively in these spaces at any one time, and the outdoor areas will be closing at 11 p.m. So on this basis, we respectfully request Council support the application and direct that a permit issues. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillors, any questions of the submitter? Councillor Gill.
Thank you. Is there any plans for future extension of the patronage numbers in the future?
There could be potentially, but my instructions at this time are what we're proposing is what they're seeking.
Thank you for your honest answer. Is there any control over amplified music? Will there be amplified music if this goes ahead?
I believe the conditions include no live music. There may be background music. But
that could be amplified.
The amplified music would have to comply with the noise requirements listed in the permit and the EPA regulations.
Yep. I hear EPA regulations all the time. It's meaningless. But
They're there for a reason. Respectfully, Councillor, they're there for a reason. They are enforceable. And our client fully intends to comply with those.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. Councillor Chelly.
Thank you for your submission. I just want to talk a little bit about the objections that have actually been received. Was there a planning application conference held with yourself or the applicant to answer most of the objections? And what were mostly the themes that you heard through those objections, and have they been addressed adequately in your view?
Yes, thank you, Councillor Selly. We attended the conference. I attended personally, and we spoke with the objectors. Their concerns were mostly what I just spoke about then, about the built form, potential for noise, the car parking reduction, and the liquor. And we discussed those and tried to reach an understanding, some common ground. And then we also worked further with the council planning department after that meeting to provide additional material, such as the acoustic assessment, the 3D renders, and updated plans, as well as an updated traffic report. So we believe we have thoroughly considered all those concerns and addressed them appropriately. Yeah.
There are concerns about the third story that's actually set back. the plans and the designs, or did you have any consideration to actually reduce the height of that third story or remove it altogether? Because it seems to be a contentious issue. So,
when you say third story, councillor, which?
Well, you've got the ground floor, the first floor, and then that top story that brings it up to about 9.5 metres. Yeah.
So the reason why I point that is that under the planning scheme, that roof terrace is not considered a story because it doesn't have a roof.
Yep.
The third story element, I guess, would be the staircase overrun. In terms of the overall height, this site's in the commercial one zone. There are no built form controls. There's no height limit. And in terms of the presentation of that stair overrun and potential visual bulk or presentation to the street, we believe that's been treated and set back well enough to not be a major element. And we believe the 3D renders demonstrate that. So yes, it was considered in terms of the height, but given it's a very small part of a mainly two-storey building, we think that's acceptable.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Chilley. Councillor Maher.
Thank you, through the Mayor. Thank you for coming in and submitting this and talking to it. Even though the top story is set back, there's no shelter up there, and we've got the sun setting in the west, so we'll get most of that sun and the elements. Do you plan to put up, one, umbrellas, or some sort of structure to aid shelter? And secondly, because that area will be open till 11 p.m., will you be pushing some sort of heating for the patrons? Thank you.
We haven't discussed those details with our client at this stage, but I would imagine for any comfortable use of that space during colder or warmer months, then some sort of temporary shade would be provided and temporary heating. Any permanent structure or permanent infrastructure would require planning permission. So again, council would have the discretion to assess that proposal put forward. So at this stage, we're not seeking permission for anything permanent there, but we are within our rights to put up umbrellas or patio heaters on a temporary basis. Yeah.
Thank you, Councillor Maher. Councillor O'Connor.
Thank you, Mayor, and through you, I just wondered, what's the height of the acoustic treatment that you're planning to put in place for the noise?
From memory, they're 1.8 metre high glass balustrades. Yeah.
And is that from the floor?
Yes.
Thank you, Councillor O'Connor. Any other questions, councillors, of the submitter? No? Thank you, Mr. Williams.
Thank you.
Can I now call forward, please, our second and final submitter, Mr. David Mooney. Welcome, Mr. Mooney. Councillors, Mr. Mooney is making a submission in objection to the planning application. Mr. Mooney, after you've spoken, you'll have a three-minute time limit. After you've spoken, are you happy to take questions from councillors?
Yes, I am.
Thank you. The time will start when you start speaking.
Hey, Mr. Mayor, fellow councillors, ladies and gentlemen, my name is David Mooney and I am an objector and full-time and permanent resident at 4 Bay Road, Mount Martha. As one of the residents who will be potentially most affected by this development, I'd like to present our major concerns to you. Number one is the issue of parking. Although we can see this won't be a problem all the time, we appreciate just how incredibly difficult and crazy car parking can be on weekends and during the warmer months. Effectively doubling the capacity of this restaurant will perpetuate this problem. And number two and number three concerns are the hours of operation and the potential noise levels emanating from this establishment. As we live directly opposite this proposed development, approximately 50 metres from door to door, we're extremely concerned with the potential for an increase in noise levels. I know the recommendations from council are that all patrons will be removed from the outdoor areas at 11 p.m. But 11 p.m. is still very late to have 40 patrons on the rooftop deck and 20 on the front balcony talking, laughing, drinking and overall enjoying themselves. Some nights in summer we can clearly hear people on the beach 200 to 300 metres away, not 50 or 60 metres across the road. The balcony and rooftop deck are outdoor areas which will lend themselves to potentially host special events such as 21sts, weddings, etc. And it will be noisy. There's no doubt about it. Our other concerns relating to this is who is going to police the removal of the patrons on the front balcony or the rooftop deck after 11 p.m. Will the restaurant close the sliding doors to the balcony on the front balcony at 11 p.m. to contain the noise of up to 60 patrons who are now inside enjoying themselves? Or will this noise just escape into the atmosphere directly opposite our home? What if a small group of four or five or six patrons want to step outside for a smoke? Five or six patrons out on the front deck, front balcony, smoking, laughing and talking at midnight, directly opposite our home. We will hear that. How these concerns will be addressed has not been made clear. A 1 a.m. seven days a week closing time for a restaurant with a license to serve alcohol to 60 patrons is, in my opinion, completely inappropriate for the Mount Martha Village and especially the residents that live nearby. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mooney. Councillors, are there any questions of the submitter? Mr. Mooney, I have a couple of questions for you.
Yes.
We're well aware of the issues in Mount Martha with car parking. They are long-standing. I'm wondering, in your view, as a resident living so close to the village, a long-term resolution for the car parking, do you think this can be handled on a case-by-case basis with planning applications, or does it need a bigger solution?
I think it needs a bigger solution, much bigger solution. It's a huge problem, as you know.
Do you have any issues with noise at the moment out of the village?
Not especially, and I wouldn't say one business is worse than another. There is an issue with a bar operating directly over the road from us at the moment, which is causing a few problems in summer. But I mean, the restaurant, the current Indian restaurant across the road from us, is no issues have arisen from that operation since we've been living there in the last 10 years.
And did you attend the planning application conference?
No, I did not. We were away.
Right. No further questions from me. Councillors, any other questions? Councillor Marsh.
Hi, David. I guess as a Mount Martha local, I was keen just to get your views, and you've expressed them already, but do you, in your view, think that this application opens up the door, I guess, to this side of the village particularly, but the village more broadly changing forever?
If I can say that overall, I don't have an issue with the application. I think it would be a fantastic business if it was operating in the main part of Mount Martha, facing the beach. It's the fact that it's facing residential properties and going to be open till 1 a.m. in the morning, 7 days a week. Yeah, I think it could change a lot of things in Mount Martha. Other restaurants could say, well, if they're open till 1 o'clock, why can't we get a permit to open till 1 o'clock? I think it's unnecessary.
And by that, you're sort of alluding to the fact that most of the restaurants at the moment are down the other end of the village.
The other end, yeah. Most of them, I think the latest any of those open is 11 o'clock.
Yeah. And parking, I guess, on the back of the Mayor's question, we already have, in my view, a massive issue of parking in Mount Martha. Yeah. And this is one application, but just say the other cafes and restaurants all went down the same path.
Yeah.
How do you see parking looking in 5 years' time?
It would be horrendous. I mean, it's horrendous now. Mm. Probably been there on those hot summer's days where, you know, they're double parked up Bay Street and miles away.
Yeah.
I don't know how you resolve the issue of parking.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Councillor Dixon.
Thank you, Mayor. I think in part the question's been answered, but my concern or question was going to be, would you feel the same if it was situated in Lochiel Avenue over the beach rather than at Inn Bay Road?
I wouldn't feel the same, no.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Dixon. Councillor Bissinger.
Through the Mayor, I'm just looking at the aerial map here, and I noticed it looks like quite a busy road in front of your property, which I presume is anywhere from 1 to 5.
That's correct, number 4. Yeah,
and that even looking at your property, it is a very, very long way from the actual front of the premises of the restaurant. And I just wonder, with road noise, because I'm very sensitive to road noise myself, can you imagine that the regulated noise that will be within a certain decibel frame, or there's trouble kind of an issue, do you think that would be any worse than busy traffic on a road?
Yes, I do. Yeah, I do, because it's the hours of operation. It's those late nights where there's much less traffic travelling along Bay Road. The Esplanade's a little bit different, but along Bay Road, the traffic significantly decreases after about 7 o'clock at night.
And I realise that the issue is ongoing with once it starts, it's sort of there forever.
Yeah.
But would you have the same issues if the neighbours on these massive blocks had, for example, a few friends over that were talking in the 21st or something like that? You know, there's got to be some tolerance there.
I would have no problems with that, because you know it's only even one night.
Even though they're right next to you and the noise factor there.
It's always going to be an issue though, isn't it?
It is, totally. I'm just still trying to grapple with the sheer amount of land between...
A further question, Councillor Bissinger?
I'm just trying to understand, and just want to know how you envisage, what level of noise do you think? Like, we've got all the acoustic reports, but what level of noise are you concerned about? Like, what have you done any worked out any decibels that would have you been able to have an example of the noise coming out of there and see how it really affects the place?
Yes, I have. As in, we have been subjected to the premises that is immediately to the left of this proposed development, 3 Bay Road. They're operating as a bar cafe at the moment, right at the moment. And during summer, people sitting out the front of that cafe, drinking, enjoying themselves, which is fantastic, create enormous amount of noise. Enormous amount of noise directly opposite our property. Now, if it was in the main part of...
70 metres from...
Well, it's not. Well, it's 20 metres from our front door.
Any further questions, Councillor Bissinger?
It's 50 to 60 metres away. That's all it is. It's not a long way.
Councillor Maher?
Thank you, through the Mayor. Mr Mooney, I've just got the police report here, and they've noted the proposed site for this venture is directly across the road and in close proximity to residents' property on Bay Road. Is what you're talking about, and police have recommended that noise be considered, and this seems to be one of the most contentious issues that we're talking about here. Would you accept, if there wasn't a top bar and restaurant, would you accept that there could be a two-storey restaurant and dining like there is around the corner? Well, Pino and Mr. Curtis upstairs, although they're upstairs, not downstairs. How would you feel about that?
I think it would be much more desirable if there wasn't a rooftop deck. And the other issue, obviously, is the 1 o'clock closing. If you've got a business operating till 1 a.m. in the morning, it's potentially going to be noisy. Potentially.
Thank you, Councillor Maher. Councillors, any other questions of our submitter? Councillor Bissinger?
I just would like to know, Ms. Murray, I'd just like to know historically the timing of this. You say you've got a bar just over the road. Yep. Is it just the summertime that is the major issue for you?
Yes, it is. Well, it's when it's operating. It mainly seems to be busy in the warmer months.
Okay, so we're talking about January? Is that what you think?
We're talking about up till April. When people are drinking and dining outside.
It's like someone having a barbie all the time.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you, Councillor Bissinger. No further questions, councillors? No? All right, thank you, Mr. Mooney.
Thank you.
Councillor Bissinger-Roper, could I just get you to turn that microphone off, please?
Thank you.
Councillors, that concludes the submissions for this planning item, 4.1. We have an officer recommendation before us. Does any councillor wish to move a motion to that effect or otherwise? No, we've had sufficient time for questions, Councillor Gill. Yes, we've had briefings and pre-meets. How many questions do you have, Councillor Gill? You asked the questions and you received answers for those questions. Councillor Gill, could you please withdraw that remark? Councillor Gill, you've had sufficient time to ask questions. You've had sufficient time to ask questions of the officers. Through briefings, through pre-meet. What is your public question, Councillor Gill? Yes. What is your question? Councillor Gill, what is your question?
Thank you, and through the chair. In relation to the first part of that question, the relevance of whether it's 29 or 24 is somewhat immaterial given that there is no ability to provide parking on site. In relation to ongoing impacts, that would have to be assessed on the merits of each case put before council.
Councillor Celli, you had a question? No? Councillor Gill, further question?
Thank you, and through the chair, they'd be enforceable conditions like any other permit. They would be enforceable conditions like any permit conditions. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. Councillors, are there any other questions? Councillor Gill, one more question and then we'll proceed through to the item. Councillor Marsh, you've got a question?
I guess one for Mr. Simon. Is there anything like this anywhere in the entirety of Mount Martha in terms of a two-storey plus a, you know, three-storey, call it that, or a rooftop?
Thank you, and through the chair, I'm not aware of any other rooftop premises in the locality. They're all two-storey. And there's the example with the spire, the building with the spire just down the road. That's the only one that's probably taller than this one.
Thank you.
Yes, thanks, Councillor Gill.
Thank you, and through the chair, I'm not sure I can answer that, as we can't account for what VCAT may or may not do in the future.
Thank you, Mr. Simon. Councillor Bissinger, you've got Councillor O'Connor as well. Councillor Bissinger, what is your question?
My question is, does this fit? It says in the report that it fits within the planning scheme. Could you just confirm that, that this project, in how it's set out, fits within the planning scheme?
Thank you, and through the chair, officer's recommendation is that it generally does comply with the planning scheme provisions, although they are seeking variations to multiple things such as the car parking and the local policy.
Thank you, Mr. Simon. Councillor O'Connor, you've got a question?
Yeah, just one. It's in regards to the permit for a restaurant. If the facility or restaurant is going to be open till 1 a.m, is the kitchen also open to that time, or does it need to be open to that time to serve alcohol up until then?
Thank you, and through the chair, there's technically no restrictions on what time the restaurant can open till, because we're not granting permission for the use of the restaurant. It's the liquor that's the permission that's being granted here.
All right, councillors, we've had sufficient time for questions and answers. There is a recommendation before us. Councillor Marsh, do you wish to move a motion?
Thanks, Mayor. I'd like to move an alternate councillor motion, please.
Thank you, Councillor Marsh. Councillors, this was circulated earlier today. I'll take that as moved by Councillor Marsh. Councillors, is there a seconder?
Yes, I'd like to second, but can I add a Part C?
If it is agreeable to the mover.
Yeah, that's fine. I've seen it. Thanks.
Councillor O'Connor, I assume that is the amendment that you would also circulate.
Yeah. This little bit here. Council undertakes an urban design framework to determine the appropriate built form in the commercial area of Mount Martha.
Sorry, we changed the wrong part there, I think.
It should be Part C.
They're combined. Okay. Right, that's clear. Is there a seconder? Councillor O'Connor, to second that. Thank you, councillors. Councillor Marsh, to open debate.
Thanks, Mayor Holland. As a Mount Martha local, I know this area extremely well during the day, during peak, off-peak, and particularly at night. And as our objector said, it's a bit of a sleepy hollow after about 7 or 8 o'clock, particularly at this end of Mount Martha. And if you look at that area, and if you haven't been there recently, I would highly encourage you to go there, particularly in the evening. There's nothing in that back half that's above one level. This proposal is not just two level, but two level with a rooftop bar. So effectively a three level, whether we want to call it that or not. And in my view, it's entirely out of character with this area, and it will change the Mount Martha Village character and vibe forever. And you can just imagine that if this was to go through and to be built, you would imagine any landlord along that entire strip would be looking at opportunities to do the same. So this is a first of its kind in this area, and it's something that we should take incredibly seriously if you want to protect the village beachside character that is Mount Martha. Often it's confused that Mount Martha, Mornington, sometimes Mount Liza are the same, but Mount Martha and Mornington could not be further apart in terms of their village character. We all know that Main Street Mornington has its bars and its clubs and its multi-storey apartment complexes, but that's not Mount Martha, and it's something that hopefully won't be there anytime soon. But as you can imagine, if you live on Bay Road, or even if you're just a local, to go from this village that, you know, after 7 o'clock is basically asleep at this end, to having 40 people, you know, having a good time on a third-storey rooftop bar, you will change the character forever. So I think from that point of view, I'm not supportive of this application at all. And I think, you know, there's always a bit of discretion in interpretation whether or not it complies with character and built form and that sort of thing. But my perspective is that it doesn't. And again, I'll really encourage any councillor that is sort of sitting on the fence on this one to question whether you've been there recently and whether you really understand the character in person. Parking has been a bugbear of mine since well before I got on council, but particularly since I came to council. It is an issue that even today, during peak hours, it's very difficult sometimes to get a park at Mount Martha. And we say, well, you know, after 5 o'clock, it's a bit quieter. And that's true, but that's because this type of venue doesn't exist. Imagine when there's 10 of these and you've got 25 odd car parks that are being waived. That's 250 car parks that we don't have. So again, from a car parking capacity point of view, I think this is absurd until we've done something to address that problem first. The other issue is obviously about the timing to 1 o'clock serving alcohol at a venue like this. Again, I think it's a bit out of character, but I'm less concerned about the use, and that's obviously not really something that we're looking at today. It's more that built form and parking that I take an issue with. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Marsh. Councillor O'Connor, do you wish to speak as the seconder?
I'll reserve my right, please, Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor O'Connor. Is there a speaker against the motion? Councillor Chelly.
Thank you. I'll keep this brief, and I cannot support a refusal for this planning application in the Mount Martha Village there. I just can't reconcile the planning dissonance where you have an officer's report that under the planning policy framework actually has approved this application. If you look at it on its own minutes in regards to the planning policy framework, the officers have outlined in the report the reasons why it meets all the requirements under the policy framework and the zoning as well. I understand that in Mount Martha Village that there are parking issues. I don't believe these parking issues have existed there forever. There's a different strategy that can deal with those, but I don't think that all the car parking issues, past, present or future, can be blamed on this planning application whatsoever. In regards to the built form, I understand the overall built form height does go to about 9.5 metres because there is that top storey that's actually on up the top there that brings it over to that 9.5 metres. But I don't see this an actual detriment or actually detracts from the Mount Martha Village Centre itself. If anything, I think the design is quite complementary to the area. It is a small township activity centre, and the officers have assessed this planning application in accordance with all of that. It doesn't change the footprint. I don't believe it's an anomaly compared to the other businesses actually sweep around that commercial centre either. There's you know, the restaurants on the other side, and there are residential houses everywhere within that precinct from the Mount Martha Commercial Centre as well. So, no, I can't support the refusal. Also, I believe that there are no grounds really for refusal that can actually stand up at VCAT, and that concerns me greatly as well, because this is where we have the control mostly on the planning application before us. So I totally understand the residents' concerns, but in regards to the noise pollution, the traffic, the car park, I mean, that is Mount Martha Village. It does peak in the summertime, but I don't believe that this application will be detrimental. If anything, the officer's report actually says it adds a positive benefit to the village itself. So there's nothing wrong with a little bit of change, and if it does inspire, you know, others to maybe enhance the buildings there or make them a little bit more contemporary, well, that will be on a case-by-case application there. So I can't support a refusal tonight, and I look forward, possibly, if this motion doesn't get up, I'm happy to support the alternate councillor motion that Councillor O'Connor would put forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Chelly. Any councillor in favour of the motion? Councillor Maher.
Thank you, Mayor Holland. As councillors, we have a pivotal role in shaping long-term visions for our townships and villages. However, we know progress and change is hard to navigate and even stop. An outside bar and restaurant on top of a two-storey building with a protruding lift shaft on top introduces this new type of development and entertainment in this area. I see this as a quantum leap from what the village has and already exists with its eating and drinking venues. This type of entertainment and bar belongs in major activity centres, not a village. On parking, our locals struggle in high season as it is now, and even around lunchtime onwards in the low season, I've experienced a lot of congestion there. Second to that, on noise, noise carries more at night as well. If you're only having the, what was it, 1.8 metre clear or glass, if you've got people up there, I'm hoping that there's some sort of security around that. And also, speaking about security, will there be security on site? We know that police may be a little bit slow in the uptake. If there's issues there, I suggest security. With the rooftop exposed and there's no cover, we've got the western sun that beats down there. And it also gets very windy there too. So if you've got umbrellas up, I don't know how they're going to make sure that they're very secure. So what has been presented to us tonight by Councillor Marsh, and thank you for bringing that, I think it's worth debate and it's worth looking at very closely, because this will be the start of nightclubs, I would suggest, in Mount Martha Village. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Marsh. Is there a speaker against the motion? Councillor Bissinger.
Through the Mayor. It's a sad thing that time doesn't stand still, but it's something that we have to move with. The entire bank of well-established, similar-looking commercial premises will probably be expanded to make the associated businesses more viable and able to provide for their communities and visitors alike. It's just the way it goes. What is being requested here marries up with what is already available in this area when it comes to opening times and licensing, so there shouldn't be an issue with much of that. This development fits within the current planning scheme. Actually, it probably could have been more extensive and still fitted within the scheme, and will be it will be difficult to defend a refusal not only in this chamber but also at VCAT. Parking Mount Martha on other parts of the peninsula is an issue that needs to be addressed on a large scale. It's not something that we should be attributing to individual applicants at this stage when it's the whole of the area that needs to have additional parking. The noise issue, which comes up, 60 metres is a long way from the type of noise that was explained to me, being people talking, laughing, drinking, and coming 60 metres is a long way for that to carry, especially on the rooftop where you have 1.8, that's taller than most of us here, 1.8 metre high glass panels baffling the noise. So it's sort of it's difficult for me to see where this doesn't work. This is not a particularly historical area, meaning there's nothing there that is I think been registered as historical, or this is just a regular kind of shopping strip. And you wonder by stopping this kind of development whether in fact you're letting things decay. Like if there's no incentive for businesses to improve, make more money, there's no incentive for them to improve their premises either. And that's something that should be really considered. If you have a limited amount of funds you can get from a certain period of time with a restaurant, you can increase that by a significant amount by increasing the number of people there, then obviously you'll have more money to make the place look and function better. And I think that's something that should be considered as well. We don't want sleepy, like, towns ending up falling completely off the planet. So that's why I can't sort of support it. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Bissinger. Any other councillor wishing to speak in favour of the motion? Councillor Gill.
Thank you. I favour the use, but I cannot vote for this application. I favour the use because in the right location, and I'm talking about our village character, and I imagine this in many of the villages, the 40 towns and villages on the Mornington Peninsula, and I know that people are waiting to gobble those up. VCAT's waiting to allow them to. But that doesn't mean that we should say to people we favour it. I like the use. I like the most things about the application, except the parking. I had an experience in Balnarring not long ago where the parking was reduced by officers and put through and recommended to councillors, and it was almost halved in a new development in the shopping centre, and immediately the people going into those shops and the owners and the people working in those shops just moved over to the main part of Balnarring and took over the parking spaces for the people who had their shops and so on in the main part of that village, because the new developments across the road. It upset a lot of people. And it wasn't very close, the back fences were, but it wasn't really very close to much housing because it had the road across to the main shopping centre. I thought that one was bad enough. But this one, we don't have an alternative for parking. Where are they going to park? Residential streets. We're going to have a lot of complaints in the future with these developments because people will have to park eventually in the residential streets, and we'll be putting restrictions in front of people, and then we'll go to the other part of Mount Martha where we give permits for people to park outside their own house or their neighbours or their friends and families. That's what will happen. The noise element, as far as EPA is concerned, and people know my views, there's no enforcement. They don't come out for anything. Doesn't matter whether it's noise or anything else. I had an asbestos problem in Red Hill. It took them a month to get there, and it was lying all over the ground in powder form as people took it down.
Point of order, relevance.
Thank you.
I'm talking about the issues we have with enforcement. Thank you, Councillor
Gill. Point of order, relevance.
Councillor Chilley, your point of order.
The debate is irrelevant to the report before us.
Thank you, Councillor Chilley. I'm going to rule in favour of the point of order. Councillor Gill, if you could return to the specific planning matter at hand. You've got 22 seconds remaining. Yeah. Thank you, Councillor.
So we're going to have a problem in the other streets. We're a pushover at VCAT. We know it, but that doesn't mean we should just tolerate what we know is wrong. We can't overcome the noise issues. We can't overcome the parking issues. This is just bad luck that a use is good, but the actual implementation of it is going to cause a lot of serious problems. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. Is there any councillor against the motion? Councillor Race.
Thank you. And I do want to thank Councillor Marsh for bringing this motion this evening. And I do understand his point and why he's proposed a refusal. But much like Councillor Chilley, I can't accept the refusal motion because of the many items outlined that Councillor Chilley spoke before in the officer's report. I do want to speak to the parking because I think what the officers have proposed have ameliorated a lot of the issues around parking with the number of patrons allowed in the building. I think it's 20 before 5 o'clock and then the 60 after 5 o'clock. And my parents do live in Mount Martha, so I do know this village very well, and I do know after 5 o'clock that the patronage at the shops around there drops off quite significantly. So I think they've done a good job with the restrictions there. I also want to speak about some of the assumptions that have been made tonight about the noise and the behaviour of the patrons. And I think that speaks to, I think it's a negative speaking about the future business that is going to be in Mount Martha. I'm assuming somebody that wants to open up a business in Mount Martha Village wants to be a good business owner and a good neighbour, and will try and rectify those issues and try and support the village as much as possible. That they want people to come to their restaurant and their bar, and they want people to enjoy that, and they want the people across the road probably to come and patron as well, because that's one less car that needs to park. They can just walk there. So I think we need to think about that and to think about the future business that will be in that place, and I'm sure that they will want to be a good neighbour and a good business in Mount Martha Village because it is such a close and incredible community that is there. So Councillor Marsh, I do understand why you brought this evening, but I can't accept it. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Race. Is there a speaker in favour of the motion? Councillor Dixon.
Thank you, and through the Mayor. I'm actually torn between this one because I support business, having owned a business in Mount Martha for many years myself. The difference is that my business was in the front, facing Lock Hill Avenue over to the beach. For that reason, I think if it was along that strip in the front with the noise going elevated straight out onto the water. I wouldn't have an objection to that. Bay Road, I must sympathise with the objector. I know how close those houses are to there, and whilst they might be 50 metres or 60 metres, whatever the thought is, noise travels. So I am concerned about that. There are times when we do require police to come to certain areas for issues that happen, and it's a long known well that policing have limited resources, and if there's an issue somewhere, Mount Martha's not first on the agenda to visit. It's not a priority unless it's something very urgent. There's also the issue of patrons leaving at 1 a.m. And then heading down to the beach and creating problems down there, which has very much happened over years. So I'm a bit hesitant about that as well. The parking, it's always been an issue, so I'll just park that one and not labour on that. But yes, I think I love the idea, and as I said, if it was in Lochiel Avenue, it might be different, but I just don't feel comfortable with it where it is here. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Dixon. Is there any speaker against the motion? Any further speaker in favour? Councillor O'Connor.
As long as there's no one else, thank you, Mayor. Mount Martha is a small seaside village, and myself and my family moved to Mount Martha from Warrigal in 2006. We moved from a regional city to a beachside village, and the regional city was probably not too much bigger than Mornington. Mount Martha back in 2006 was quiet-ish. It wasn't as busy as what it is now. And of course, in the last 5 years, since the pillars were discovered, we've had massive amount of parking issues in our village. We have some great restaurants. We have some great cafes. We have great retail stores in our little village. Every shop is full, every single one, which that's something to be proud of. It's a thriving little community. But I have had concerns about this rooftop area from the start. And even the police in the police report say that the rooftop deck will increase noise to the area. That was their concern. And yes, I guess that was their basic concern. It is going to increase noise. And that's something that I'm concerned about, because after about 7:30, the restaurants in the area often close their kitchens and people start to head off home between 8:30 and 9 o'clock. And it is very quiet. It gets very quiet because there are four restaurants in Mount Martha. So it is a quiet space after 9 o'clock. But staying open till 1 is quite different. Now, at the other end of Mount Martha, we have a restaurant that has a balcony. And if we had have had a first floor and a balcony, I probably wouldn't be in this situation. And at that one, the liquor licence is until 11 p.m. And we're asking for 2 hours more at the other end. And I just think that's too much in a space that's quiet, both ends of Mount Martha. So I'm going to support Councillor Marsh's refusal and see where this goes. But I'd ask councillors to think about the impacts of a rooftop bar on a small community. And I have actually put in into the refusal a clause to talk about and think about strategy moving forward about the urban design framework of this area, because at the moment it's a commercial zone. It has no DDO, and I guess one cat pops out of the bag and we make a change that's quite significant.
Thank you, Councillor O'Connor.
There may be others.
Councillor Marsh, to close.
Thank you for the opportunity, Mayor. At risk of lecturing councillors about our role, I just want to point out, or I guess respond to one comment that was made in the arguments against this motion, and it was basically that officers have approved it, it complies with the scheme, we're good to go. Firstly, it's not an approval, it's a recommendation on balance from officers. And secondly, if that's kind of the attitude we take, then why do we even show up and have these meetings as councillors? We're here to represent the community and overlay that on a report that's put to us. We're not here just to accept a report that says it complies and rubber stamp it. This particular application had 30 objectors. In a small place like Mount Martha, that is significant, particularly given that the advertising is very limited. I'm sure if you stood at the village and surveyed every person that walked into the IGA, you would get hundreds more. And that's what I've got just from talking to people that live there. This is completely out of character. And if this was to happen across that entire strip, it would change the Mount Martha village as we know it for good. Councillor Bissinger, you talked about, I guess, allowing businesses to grow and, I guess, echoing the thoughts of others. Had this been a doubling of the floor space and a restaurant, that's giving that business ample opportunity to grow. If anything, I'm normally accused of being too pro-business, so I completely understand that sentiment. But that's not the problem. It's going a step too far. We're not saying turn the cafe into a restaurant. We're saying turn the cafe into a restaurant and then add a third-story bar on top. I think there is a limit, and we need to be the ones that are that final, I guess, sanity check to challenge these applications that come in front of us. Officers have obviously formed a view, that's fine, but as we all know, planning is open to interpretation and discretion, and that's why there are winners and losers, and it's never crystal clear when it does go to VCAT. So on balance, my view is that this does not meet the tests of character, that sort of... I can't even remember the word now. The frontal character of the area, I think the two or three story, depending on how you interpret it, is inappropriate. And it, as we've heard, is the first of its kind in this area. And parking, you know, to say that everyone will be assessed on its merits, that's while that might be technically correct, it's madness to say, but, you know, let's not look at it holistically. Again, if 10 of these get up, that's potentially 250, 300 car parks that we don't have that we're waiving. And we see this problem now in places like the industrial estates or Main Street Mornington. We're just constantly giving 90% waivers to parking because we don't have an option. We're looking at the start of this problem in Mount Martha, and we're basically setting ourselves up to fail in the same way. So on the basis of parking, character, and the comments we've already said, I can't support this, and I'd hope that councillors get behind the motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Marsh. That concludes debate. I'll put the matter to the vote. All those in favour?
By division, thanks.
By division, requested by Councillor Marsh. All those in favour, please stand. Councillor Gill, Councillor O'Connor, Councillor Marsh, Councillor Dixon, Councillor Roper, Councillor Maher, Councillor Brooks, and against? Councillor Bissinger, Councillor Race, Councillor Celli and Councillor Holland. The motion is carried. The permit application is refused. Thank you, councillors. We now proceed to item 4.2 in our agenda, the draft David McFarlane Reserve Master Plan. Councillors, there is a motion before us. Does any councillor wish to move a motion to that effect or otherwise? Councillor Race, seconded. Councillor Bissinger. Councillor Race, do you wish to open debate?
I'll keep it short and sweet. This one has been labouring for a long time, but happy to see that it's going out to on public exhibition. I think it's a great result for the community of Sorrento, particularly the cricket and netball clubs who are desperately after new facilities. So I think it'll be great to get it out on public exhibition, hear what the people of the good folk of Sorrento think about it, and then actually get it into place, because that will be great. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Race. Councillor Bissinger, did you wish to speak as the seconder? Any other councillor wishing to speak on this item? No, Councillor Bissinger.
Thank you, and through the Mayor. After claiming the title of the worst cricket nets in the Shire, and having historically non-compliant netball courts with dangerous wire offences for many years, the David McFarlane Reserve in Sorrento was considered for a makeover. It's these two items and the associated safety hazards that are the primary concern of stakeholders in our community. Council has promised that the cricket nets will start this year and the netball courts will be completed within 2 years. Whilst the entire process has been an extremely frustrating experience, we are hoping that the plan put forward tonight gets passed to start works on the two main areas of concern. Of course, this is disappointing that the rest of the plan, including safety issues with the entry and exit point, won't be addressed in the near future, but rather as part of a 20-year plan. However, this is also an opportunity for stakeholders to get a better result in subsequent master plans and address our changing sporting needs. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Bissinger. Any other councillor wishing to speak? No? With nobody speaking against, I'll put the matter to the vote. All those in favour? Carried unanimously. Thank you, councillors. We now move to the Community Strengthening Directorate, item 4.3, response to notice of motion 400. Councillors, there is a recommendation before us. I've had a couple of potential amendments flagged by Councillor O'Connor and Councillor Gill. Councillor O'Connor, did you wish to... You'd like to move a motion? Okay. So if we could please bring up the wording for Councillor Gill's motion. Okay, an additional part will be Councillor O'Connor's amendment.
Happy to include it, Mayor.
All right, moved by Councillor Gill. Is there a seconder? There's no... Councillor Brooks to second. Councillor Gill to open debate.
Thank you. I didn't know that I need to speak, but I wish to point out that the intention here is to keep this matter public, to keep it going and do more than... The officers have done a great job and they've got a recommendation, but it doesn't go far enough to keep this on top of the list of the public. Moving into... the next week or two, we need to have people talking about this. So that's the intent. Behind that also is to make sure that people understand that there are vacant houses, hundreds of them, not being maintained and put to use. And I don't think we can talk about that enough. That on the peninsula and at the AAA housing meeting that Councillor Challey attended, we heard from the horse's mouth. We heard from the department person that actually organises the maintenance. And he told us the numbers. He told us the time and he told us why. Because they have a major contract and the contract can't do houses as they come up. There's wait for a pool of houses and then they go and do them all together. And sometimes, and he told us, sometimes it takes years to get to the Mornington Peninsula and get to the houses on the Mornington Peninsula. So I hope that people or councillors will support this on the basis that that's not good enough. And we should be making as much noise as we can to ensure that the public, even if the minister's not listening, even if the department's not listening, but the public know, because we had hundreds of people come to Wilson's Hall, the old school hall, several times showing concern about this issue and going out on cold winter nights too. to show concern. We've got Homelessness Week where we're planning to have functions and things and walks and things. We can tell people this, that we're doing something, that we're trying. We're trying to make it as loud as we can and not just have it as one of the things that we do. This is one of the most important things that we can possibly do. On these cold nights, we have people sleeping out in the open. And unless we do something, who is going to? Because at the moment, the people who are doing the hard work, the not-for-profits on the peninsula, from the Salvos to the three support centres, they're out there helping. Our officers, our housing people, are doing what they can. But now it's up to councillors to make sure that the message is getting across. And as we know with communication, it's the most difficult thing to do. With all the competing interests and the competing matters that we need to talk about to get the message out there. So that's why it's there. It may be seen as not quite necessary because we've already got it covered in the report, or we've got it covered by officers. But now there's quotes, and I hope some more quotes to go with it and a story to go with it, and the public might hear and even perhaps one day the minister. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. Councillor Brooks, did you wish to speak?
I'll reserve my right at this stage. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Is there any speaker against the motion? Councillor Bissinger.
Through the Mayor, I just look at the way we've approached a lot of things with the state government, and we always try to be in their face, make it loud. We had a huge and what was considered a successful campaign for housing and homelessness during our last big advocacy push. We had a lot of media attention on radio, on in papers, everywhere. We had a lot of attention, and all of it was to no avail. We didn't even get a response from the minister. And I'm just wondering if perhaps we should really consider changing our tactics slightly. And if that means being firm and professional rather than trying to drum up sort of an intense, haphazard kind of reaction, then I think that might be... We haven't done that before. And I'm just thinking that maybe it's something that we should really consider rather than having such a oppositional way to hit the ministers. There are plenty of things that we could say, plenty of things that we could do that actually could be to help the state government, and rather than trying to be in their face and oppositional to them all the time. And I think that is what we should, as a council, start to look at. How can we help the state government help us? And I think as a group, we can work through that, work it out, and see where we come up with, because what we're doing, we're doing everything we possibly can, and it's getting us absolutely nowhere. I think we have to take it from the perspective of how we can help state government and how we can make this the kind of thing that we're hoping for attractive to them, because that's the only way I feel that we're going to get any traction on this. And I'm not sure how everyone else feels, but that's certainly how I feel. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Bissinger. Any speaker in favour of the motion? Councillor Maher.
Thank you, Mayor Holland. I want to keep the momentum going on this. It's not only the Shire and the Mayor and officers writing to the Department of Housing, it's also Ben Smith, who is the CEO of the Moonta Peninsula Community Support Centre. He wrote a letter to the minister. Somebody corresponded on his behalf. And at the bottom of the letter, it said, if you have any questions, call another person. I don't know where these letters are ending up. I don't even think half the time the minister reads them. We've got to be completely... we can't lay down on this. And this is probably what the minister wants us to silence us on this, because of the reaction that we're getting on all the letters that we're sending. We've sent it. The Mayor's sent a couple, haven't had a response, especially the one that was sent at the beginning of this month. So going up to Queen's Hall at State Parliament next week, we're actually going to them rather than trying to do it from our pen here on the Mornington Peninsula. Our cries are loud. In letters that we get from the minister or any release, media release, doesn't have much there for the Mornington Peninsula and for Victoria for that fact. There's figures splashed around. I don't know if there's any truth or substance behind that. We're not seeing any action here on the ground. And that's why I want to support this motion that Councillor Gill is putting forward. And I hope that I hear from other councillors around the table too on what their thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Ma. Any speaker against the motion? Any other speakers in favour? Councillor Marsh.
Thanks, and through you, Mayor. I think I'm still waiting on my letters that I wrote as Mayor, Councillor Gill. I think this is one of those cases where the squeaky wheel may get the grease, and it's not guaranteed that we'll get it, but we definitely won't get it if we're not squeaky. So I support basically just constantly following up this issue. It's not an issue that politicians tend to want to talk about. And I think it's one where if we ask nicely and sit and wait, we'll get nothing. So I support the motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Marsh. Councillor O'Connor.
Thank you, Mayor. Yeah, I'm in support of this councillor motion as well. And it's mainly to do with the fact that we need to keep raising our voices to be heard. And the part I actually added was we know that there are groups on the Mornington Peninsula who are prepared to do some of the work on the maintenance of these properties that are sitting idle. They've spoken to many of us around the room and want to be involved, and that includes groups like Men's Sheds, Lions and Rotary, who want to be engaged in these projects. They've spoken to many of us about this, and they can't be because this is a locked space and they can't get in. I want to see that change, and I think this is an opportunity to put to the state government to see if we can do this differently and work out another way forward, and especially with so many houses on the peninsula that are vacant, that are social housing homes, we could make a difference here, a real difference to our area. I think that's all I wanted to say. I think there was one more thing, but it's just gone from my brain. But, yeah, I'd encourage councillors to continue to have these conversations and raise our voices just so that those in the halls of Parliament can hear us. And I don't think speaking too much about this issue is ever too much. And, you know, our community support centres do a whole lot of work in this space and need our support. And it's not just support in dollar figures, which we, out of the three levels of government, give the most to these centres, but they also need us side by side with them, and we know that they're after these houses as well. So let's see if we can push for that.
Thank you, Councillor O'Connor. Any other councillor wishing to speak? Councillor Race.
Yeah, thank you. And I probably agree with most of what the other fellow councillors have said tonight. But what I would like to highlight is that the state government keeps telling local government that they're not doing enough. And the Mornington Peninsula Shire is definitely showing the state government that we're doing every single thing that we can. I think at the last meeting, I put up a notice of motion about secondary dwellings and having a look at secondary dwellings here on the Mornington Peninsula. It turns out that Victoria has got the lowest amount percentage of social housing, makes up just 2.9% of the state's residential properties. That's the lowest in Australia. So we are actually helping the state government by saying, yeah, let's have a look at the Mornington Peninsula stock and get some back into the pool to help our residents. It is really important, and I agree, we do need to be the squeakiest wheel around. We do need for those politicians to know that the Mornington Peninsula needs help. And if we often talk about the bits of paper on the minister's desk, well, we may as well try and make all those bits of paper with the Mornington Peninsula Shire on. So I am in total in favour of this amendment this evening.
Thank you, Councillor Race. Any other councillor wishing to speak? Councillor Dixon.
Thank you, and through the Mayor. Thanks, Councillor Gill. As you know, we've been banging on about this forever, and just watching, especially in Hastings, houses sitting vacant, becoming derelict and then being sold off, and that money going out of our region. So that's disappointing. I know with our community that they're a strong, hard-working community, and they want to help, but their hands are tied, as Councillor O'Connor alluded to, and we've got many, you know, we're known perhaps as the tradie region of skills, and I think that there would be many people who would be willing to sacrifice their weekends to go in and help restore some of these vacant homes for people to be able to move into. And if that could be arranged in some way that even at the governing body that overlooks it at the moment, who has the contract, could even just designate a couple of people to oversee those volunteers to get that work done. It'll probably save the government a lot of money, a lot of time, and we get action a lot quicker. So I'm in support of pursuing that as much as we possibly can, and anything to get our people off the streets and out of the beaches, out of their cars, families that are dire with nowhere to live. We need to help them.
Thank you, Councillor Dixon. Any other speaker? Councillor Roper.
Thank you, Mayor Holland. Just reiterating what everyone else has said. We knew anecdotally that there were a lot of vacant public houses on the peninsula that were just vacant, some and in various states of disrepair, some of them quite badly damaged. So we understand that some of them would take some time to fix, but just this has been going on for years. We've been writing and to the state, and perhaps now we haven't got the Commonwealth Games, they're saying that we're going to do a lot more building of public housing. Maybe here's a good opportunity to keep prodding, just keep prodding, and hopefully we'll get somewhere. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Roper. Any other speaker? Councillor Brooks.
Thank you, through the Mayor. Yes, thank you, Councillor Gill, for putting some more meat onto what the original motion was. So it does quantify, I suppose, the fact that we do have a significant number of houses that are sitting there underutilised or not utilised. And the other good aspect, I think, of this alternative motion is that it articulates some specific actions and invites government to work with us to come to these solutions or to join us in providing these solutions. So I'm highly supportive. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Brooks. Any other councillor wishing to speak? No? Councillor Gill to close. Is your microphone on, Councillor Gill?
I'll start again very quickly. Thank you to the councillors. Thank you to the officers who provide the information and the research for us. I'd like to also thank Councillor Chelly, who's probably for over a decade has been working on AAA housing and these issues, and probably more councillors before Councillor Chelly doing the same thing, trying to get attention, trying to get change, and council has been doing the work. Council has been providing land, providing buildings, doing what the state government hasn't been doing. We provide to our three support centres $235,000 annually to each one, nearly $750,000. The state government provides $10,000 to each one. They're the stark figures. We are filling the gap, and it's not officially a council responsibility or should come from ratepayers' money, but we do it because we have to. We need to, and morally we do it. Just do it. So we have recently gone from the sixth worst municipality for rough sleepers in Victoria to the fourth worst. That's astonishing, but it's also horrible to think that we have not cut through. Now, if I transfer to Councillor Bishinder, if I look at the motion, I don't see anything in the motion that is going to be too upsetting to anyone. It's just writing again, pointing out the facts. That's what the motion is, if you look at the motion. I'd like to, you know, do more. I'd like, if I thought they would come, I'd be inviting ministers down here, but they won't. They'll come down to meet some lobby group, but they won't come down to meet council. They just won't. On this issue, it doesn't matter how important the issue, but on virtually any issue, they'll make an announcement and they might have a chat to the mayor or someone, but they're not really interested in the Mornington Peninsula. we have got to get them interested or our rough sleeping will increase and we'll eventually end up as the worst in Victoria for having people sleep on these cold winter nights outside. We need their help, we need their assistance because we can't do it all out of ratepayers' money, we just don't have enough ratepayers. So that's the real points, and I didn't expect to reiterate it all, but it's well worth it in a sense to make sure that we understand what we're doing, and we should be at least satisfied doing what we can.
That concludes debate. I'll put the matter to the vote. All those in favour? Against? Motion carried.
And unanimous.
Thank you, councillors. No, not unanimous. Councillors, we now proceed to item 4.4.
Do that by division, please.
You just got in time, Councillor Gill. Item 4.3 by division, requested by Councillor Gill. All those in favour? Councillor Gill, Councillor O'Connor, Councillor Marsh, thanks. Councillor Dixon, Councillor Roper, Councillor Bissinger, Councillor Race, Roper, Ma, Brooks, Chelly, against Holland. Motion carried. Division requested by Councillor Gill. Councillors, we now proceed to item 4.4, which is the draft community facilities hire policy. There is an officer recommendation before us. Does any councillor wish to move a motion to that effect? Councillor Race to move. I'm seeking a seconder. Councillor Bissinger. We've had sufficient time for questions, Councillor Gill. Councillor Bissinger, you're seconding?
No.
No? Seconder? Councillor O'Connor?
I want to get home early.
I'd like to flag an amendment.
Councillor Race to open debate.
Look, I don't have much to say on this draft community policy. It's going out for public exhibition and I want to hear what the community have to say about it. Although I did want to highlight there was something that I really quite liked in the policy is the waiver of fees to charity organisations. And I think that's a really great step forward for our community. And, so I'd just like to get this on public exhibition so we can hear from people in our community about what they think about it.
Thank you, Councillor Race. Councillor O'Connor, did you wish to speak?
No, I reserve my right. Thank you.
Any speaker against the motion? Councillor Chelly?
Not so much against the motion, but I'm just wondering if I would be permitted to move a procedural motion that the motion now be put.
Yes, Councillor Chelly?
Procedural
motion that the motion be put.
Through the Mayor, I've already flagged an amendment. Thank you.
Councillor Chelly, an amendment was flagged before you indicated a procedural motion, so I feel obligated to accept the amendment to be put, at least allow that to be debated. On that note, Councillor Bissinger, did you wish to move an amendment?
Through the Mayor, yes, I would. I've already presented it.
Councillors, we have the wording for the amendment before us. Is there a seconder? Councillor Gill to second. Seconded by Councillor Marsh. Councillor Gill. Could the minutes reflect that Councillor Marsh has left the chamber? The amendment has been put. Councillor Bissinger to open.
Through the Mayor, it's sad that we even have to consider being so specific and definitive in possible issues that could arise that affect the safety of our children. Recent evidence shows that we must be careful and protective, not just from one group, but from many. This is not about demonising any group, rather it's about providing safe environments for our children and young people. As a person, I have to do what I feel is the right thing, even though it's not popular. These troubling times and sometimes the most fundamental and basic moral beliefs have to be reinforced. We are the last hope. Whilst legislation covers the safety of children, we can stop community property being used for what could be considered dangerous practices, and we need to stand firm. Can somebody read out the actual amendment? Oh, I can read it out? Why did nobody want to read it out?
Right, Councillor Bissinger, your clock is ticking down.
Got plenty of time. Point H is hire will not be considered if the activities include the sexualisation of children or minors or the exposure of children or minors to sexually motivated activities, including full or partial nudity, lewd or explicit behaviour, and all regulations apply to adult clubs and relevant state and federal government legislation as well. And this was in point 5.18.2, the assessment. In assessing an application, the Shire will consider the following. And I think it is important that we consider this, looking at what has happened in different situations. It's not even about trends or anything like that. It's just about really making sure that we are protecting our children and young people from anything that...
Points of order.
Could we stop the clock, please? I heard multiple at the same time then, but Councillor Chelly, you might have been the loudest. Councillor Chelly, your point of order?
Yes, my point of order is that I'm looking for the relevance. It's totally irrelevant, this topic, to the report that we have before us, which is dealing with the draft community facilities hire policy and nothing to do with young people.
Thank you. Or... point of order on relevance. Councillor Bissinger is speaking directly to the amendment. So I think it is relevant to the amendment that's being moved, and the amendment itself is to amend the policy. So I'm going to rule against the point of order. Councillor Bissinger, make sure you're speaking directly to the amendment and to the broader community facilities hire policy. Thank you.
Mayor Holland, I had a point of order as well. It's different to that.
Yes, okay.
My point of order is in regards to bringing council into disrepute. We have a child safety policy that covers all of this, and we don't need... the last statement that was made was in regards to this could happen when our child safety protection...
Councillor O'Connor, your point of order, I assume you're suggesting there's something offensive in what Councillor Bissinger was saying?
I'll go with offensive. Thank you.
Look, I'll rule against the point of order. I didn't hear anything that was offensive, so we'll return to debate. Was there a third point of order, sorry? No? Okay. If we can return to debate, and there's 3 minutes and 9 seconds on the clock, please.
Thank you, through the Mayor. I won't waste everyone's time. I just wanted to put my personal opinions forward. I felt very strongly to do this. I would have raised this as a nom because it has been something that has been bothering me for some time. But I thought, seeing we were reviewing the policy, it was a perfect time to add something in there that could be beneficial to the whole system. If we have a policy that stops dead at us, then when people apply to have, and these groups become well known, and so they, if they apply to the council to use a council or community building, then at least they will be shut off straight away. There's no looking into legislation, there's no legals, there's nothing. The council policy says no, we will not accept that, and if it's any of those things, there's no need to go any further and look into anything else. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Bissinger. Councillor Gill, as the seconder, do you wish to speak?
I notice the moan go around the room. And I didn't... I know there was an expectation that no one would second this. I get an opportunity now to say that I... do not agree, but there is a right to be heard, and if we believe that not seconding and not allowing someone to speak makes things go away, it doesn't. What makes things go away is if we speak clearly and precisely about what we think of the amendment. And there were other reasons, but when we're shutting down question time, public questions by saying that you got to raise those questions in private in a briefing.
Councillor Bill, if you could return to debating the amendment before you, please.
This is the result. My view on this is that it didn't need to be raised, but it did need to be raised because of the direction that the council's been heading in lately. So that's why I did it, and I think that people should understand you can't make things go away or hide them just by not allowing someone to speak on them. Thank you. Or ask questions.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. Is there any speaker against the amendment? Councillor Race?
This amendment isn't necessary. I don't really want to speak to the nature of the amendment itself because I know Councillor Gill thinks sometimes there is a place for this sort of thing, but the harm that this language and the publication of this sort of information can be a lot more harmful to our vulnerable populations. And that's why I didn't want to have it seconded, because we have seen this year, more than most years, the harm that this sort of language has done to our vulnerable populations, and people that I know dearly have been called out for things that they shouldn't have been called out for. But I don't want to go into it because I don't want to give it any more air because it doesn't need it. But the draft community facility hire policy in 5.1.8.2 says, in assessing an application, the Shire will consider the following at point F. If the hirer's core objectives, principles or policies conflict with the Shire's values and adopted plans, policies and strategies, and if the activities of the hirer are determined to compromise community safety to be determined in consultation with Victoria Police, then they won't be able to hire the building. And in point 7, associated documents, is the child safe standards. There is no need for this amendment to be there. It doesn't need to be spelled out. Our children are safe here on the Mornington Peninsula. There will be no... it's an unnecessary unnecessary amendment. Our children are safe in our buildings. So that's all that I want to say on this, and I hope we don't have to see another amendment like this again.
Thank you, Councillor Race. Is there any speaker in favour of the amendment? Any other speakers against? Councillor O'Connor.
Thank you, Mayor. Through this amendment, I believe we're giving airtime to disinformation when we allow an amendment such as this that's been put up tonight. Our council follows the legislated child safety standards, and that is enough. Even in this report, we talk about that. We talk about our child safety standards, and raising disinformation is not okay.
Thank you, Councillor O'Connor. Councillor Maher.
Thank you, Mayor Holland. I just like to say I think this raises more questions than answers. The child safety policy is enough. We've already covered what's happening, what could happen in our places and spaces. Questions can arise from this in its language. How rapid is this actually happening on the peninsula? How often is it happening? Why did this have to be put forward and spelt out like this? And I think the questions will be forthcoming. I don't sit comfortably with the terminologies either. Thank you. Under this sort of policy that's only going out as a draft, especially.
Thank you, Councillor Maher. Any other councillor wishing to speak? Councillor Chelly.
I'm absolutely appalled that this amendment has come before us to the council this evening. I just want to make it clear that it has no place in this report and in this item tonight. It is negligent. It is a negligent amendment, and actually it opens up like a Pandora's box of speculation, as if this council has something to hide or we know something that the community doesn't. Well, I want to be clear in this debate that we have and we take very seriously our child safety and wellbeing policy in this council and across our municipality. And frankly, I'm appalled that this amendment has come before us tonight, and I want to make it clear that we are open and transparent when it comes to our facilities. The assessment that we have in this policy, as Councillor Race has mentioned, is stringent. Everything is above board in this community, and conspiracy theories, false allegations and perceptions that slight the reputations of innocent people in our community is not appropriate. So therefore, I'm totally against this amendment.
Thank you, Councillor Chelly. Any other speaker on the amendment? Councillor Roper.
Thank you, through the Mayor. I'd just like to say I find this pretty offensive, actually, and inflammatory, and definitely not necessary when we have the draft policy going out. As Councillor Chelly said, we're all of us, everyone on the peninsula is our child safety is right up there. It's the most important thing that we do here, and it's just so it's just really disappointing to see those words up on the screen today.
Thank you, Councillor Roper. Any other councillor wishing to speak? No? In that case, that closes debate, and I'll put the amendment to the vote. All those in favour? Against? All those in favour? By division. Councillor Bissinger has requested a division. All those in favour, please stand. Councillor Bissinger, all those against? Please stand. Councillor Gill, Councillor O'Connor, Councillor Dixon, Councillor Race, Councillor Roper, Councillor Maher, Councillor Brooks, Councillor Chelly, Councillor Holland. Division requested by Councillor Bissinger. The amendment is lost. Councillor Marsh was absent. Councillor Marsh has returned to the chamber. We'll have that noted in the minutes. Councillors, we now return to substantive debate for the motion that was originally put, item 4.4. Is there any speaker in favour or against? No, no speakers against. In that case, I'll... Councillor Rose, did you want any closing remarks? No? Okay, that concludes debate, and I'll put the matter to the vote. All those in favour? Carried unanimously. Thank you, councillors. We now proceed to item 4.5, the draft parklet policy public exhibition. Councillors, there's a recommendation before us. Does any councillor wish to move a motion to that effect or otherwise? Councillor Bissinger? Did you wish to move, Councillor Bissinger? I'm seeking a mover.
This is parklets.
Councillor O'Connor to move. Is there a seconder? Councillor Maher? Any objection? No? Councillor O'Connor, do you wish to speak?
No, not really. I was pretty happy with how we went with the parklet program. There was a bit of to and fro, but I think a couple of things that stood out for me was the fact that businesses could share a parklet if they so wish, if they enter into an agreement. I think that was something good that came out of it, to share the spaces rather than taking up extra car parks if it's not necessary, if it can be shared. So that's an option for our businesses, and putting it on the table and letting our businesses know that it's now available. We'll see how it goes from there. Thank you to councillors and officers for the work done on it.
Thank you, Councillor O'Connor. Councillor Maher, did you wish to speak?
Thanks, Mayor Holland. Just quickly to say also thanks to Rebecca Levy and her team for putting this forward and giving us a direction, discussions and briefings on this, and also having some feedback already from our community and retailers. It'd be great to get some formulated feedback to the policy that is a confident policy that we can work with and for our retailers and our communities and visitors who enjoy coming down to the Mornington Peninsula and enjoying al fresco dining. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Maher. Any speaker against? With no speaker against, I will conclude debate and I'll put the matter to the vote. All those in favour? Carried unanimously. Thank you, councillors. It's almost 8:15. I'd suggest a bit of a 10-minute break, so if we could be back, please, by, say, 8:23, that would be great. We'll return to the meeting at 8:23. Thank you, councillors. Thank you, councillors, officers, members of the public in the gallery and streaming online from home. We'll resume the meeting at 8:24 p.m. Or we might have snuck in there. There we go, 8:24. We now proceed, councillors, to item 4.6, in corporate strategy and business improvement, the media relations policy. I've got two potential amendments or motions flagged, rather, and Councillor Gill, you'd proposed a motion. Could we please see the wording of Councillor Gill's motion?
It should be available. May I introduce it?
We've just got the wording of Councillor Gill's motion before us. Councillor Gill, is there anything to add, or can I seek a seconder?
I suppose it's best to seek a seconder.
Is there a seconder for Councillor Gill? Councillor Bissinger? So moved, Councillor Gill, seconded by Councillor Bissinger. Councillor Gill, do you wish to open debate?
Yes, and thank you. I know this is a difficult one because over the past 3 years or so, we've brought in more and more restrictions on councillors into this council in terms of code of conduct and other measures. And I'm hopeful that councillors will see what the consequences of that are. We have a local government act that covers all the things that need to be covered. The state government is not a friend of ours. They're not going to let councillors run loose. They cover off on all of the matters that we're concerned about, yet we keep adding to it. And a media relations policy that I think should be aimed at officers in a normal course of their functions, but not elected representatives. Imagine state and federal politicians being told what they can say and what they can't say. Just imagine. But get it clear. This is restricting councillors from free speech. That's all it does. It restricts, but there is already a restriction, state government legislation, that says that we can't do certain things. And they've well considered it and put those restrictions on. Yet we, on advice from officers, feel that we should put more restrictions on what elected representatives can say matters that I think shouldn't be restricted. We should be able to speak out. We should be able to talk to the media. We should be able to do it without anything but the normal, everyday restraints that the state government has already put on us about matters about the way we should go about it. That is enough. So my motion is to take out of the media relations policy those restrictions on councillors, taking out mention of councillors. We already got a code of conduct, which I, as most people know, haven't agreed with all the aspects of it. I'm not opposing, because we have to have a code of conduct, the state government says we do, and I'm not opposed to a code of conduct, but I don't think we should go further than what the state government has already put into it. The code of conduct for councillors is enough from the state government, but we've increased it. I think it's a mistake. I think that the very people that are imposing those and the ability for councillors to impose more restrictions are the very people that wouldn't do it to themselves. There's none of that with state and federal politicians. They just don't. They don't want restrictions on themselves, but they love restrictions on other elected representatives on the lowest rank, the ones that they can boss around and order around. And, of course, officers are then able to put those restrictions onto, with our agreement, onto councillors. It's enough. It's enough of how it was before. If we're not well behaved, we get charged. And we get charged under the Local Government Act. So take out any restrictions on local restrictions, which can be influenced by local politics, and that's in everything. I'm not talking about party politics, I'm talking about local politics. Imagine one group in a council trying to restrict another group. And with a lot of councils, it's very possible. I don't believe it's happening here. That's my belief. I look around the room and I see a fairly genial councillors, we've already seen some tough arguments tonight, but we've also seen most matters dealt with unanimously. maybe one or two votes against, but I think a majority of the matters have been unanimous. I think this is a well-meaning council. We don't need these restrictions. So that's why, and I think it might be seen as extreme by some, to take off the restrictions that we impose on ourselves. Anyway, we'll see how it goes, but I'm asking you to think about it. I know it's a bit of a change in the direction that we've done in the past. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. Councillor Bissinger, did you wish to speak as the seconder?
I reserve the right, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Bissinger. Any speaker against the motion? Councillor Chelly?
Thank you, just briefly, and thank you, Councillor Gill, for your opening debate there. But I just want to bring it back to the context. We're not looking at the Councillor Code of Conduct policy tonight. We're looking at the media relations policy. We've had one, we've just updated one, and I would like to flag that should this Councillor motion fail, that I will move the officer's recommendation with just a couple of amendments. And, yeah, I'll hear whatever else everyone else has to say in this debate.
Thank you, Councillor Chelly. Any other speaker in favour of the motion? Against the motion? No? Councillor O'Connor.
Sorry, Mayor. I will take the opportunity to speak. Free speech comes with great responsibility. It's true, and I think I really believe that this media relations policy speaks to that. It says to us, you can't just go and say whatever you want, because actually we make decisions in this chamber and we all need to accept them, whether we win or we lose. We need to accept them. That's our role as a councillor. No. Well, that's part of the Local Government Act, and that's where we need to be thinking about this. As for the Code of Conduct, I agree with Councillor Chelly. That's completely different. But it doesn't have any teeth, and actually it's just rubbish, to be honest. It doesn't help us one single iota as councillors to look after each other, to make sure that, you know, we work in a safe and acceptable workplace with each other at times. And I think that, you know, you say that it's increased. Well, actually, I don't believe that. Should we not be governed by civility and decency, I guess is my question. And part of the media relations is about thinking about how we communicate with each other, how we communicate with the public. And as councillors, we need to make sure we do that well, rather than just whatever each one of us thinks. And that could be quite different. So thinking about it as a whole, and we are a committee of the whole, I believe that the motion before us doesn't support that. So I will be looking to the next motion, hopefully, when it comes up.
Thank you, Councillor O'Connor. Is there a speaker in favour of the motion? Councillor Brooks.
Yes, thank you, through the Mayor. Yes, look, I'm supportive of this in that I suppose, concerned about the extra layering of restrictions on what councillors are and aren't able to do. There is the Code of Conduct, which is mandated under the Local Government Act, which we have, I think, a fairly rigorous Code of Conduct. So to add more layers, I think, basically, yeah, creates a greater risk of misinterpretation, or perhaps even at times a deliberate interpretation that is not perhaps in the best interests of transparency and good outcomes. So, I've seen over time more and more layers of prohibitive language being applied to policies and so on. And in some ways, I suppose I agree with Councillor O'Connor that we should have a civil discourse and we should be respectful. Sometimes the unintended consequence of providing too many layers of so-called protection can actually create perverse outcomes and make it harder. I would be very much in favour of the Code of Conduct being enforced and being used as the primary means of
holding councillors' behaviour to the test. So I'm in favour of Councillor Gill's amendment. Thank you. Or alternative motion.
Thank you, Councillor Brooks. Is there a speaker against the motion? Councillor Race.
I am speaking against the motion this evening because the Councillor Code of Conduct is separate to this. This is about our media relations policy, where we do have to view our Councillor Code of Conduct in the way that we relate to anything, but this specifically talks about the way we speak to media and about actions to do with the media. So it speaks about media releases and how we action those. And it also gives us guidelines for councillors and social media, which is really important these days. We know there's been a lot of talk around councillors' use of social media, and it is important to have those guidelines, particularly as this policy will be in place for the next council term, and there could be a whole bunch of new councillors who aren't quite sure of how they need to conduct themselves. So I think this is great. They're called guidelines for social media. It's not... the policy is there to guide us to be better in our relations, and I don't think it is stifling debate or stifling free speech. I think Councillor Gill before was talking about politicians further up the tree. Well, I do know that if you're in a party, that you very much do not get to say what you think. Sometimes
you just get expelled.
So, I think it's a common sense policy, and I think we should just pass it because it does talk about media relations and it does give us good guidelines about how to act as proper councillors. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Race. Any other councillor in favour of the motion? Councillor Marsh.
Thanks, and through you, Mayor. I think my issue with the policy is that it seems to imply that these restrictions actually matter, as in that they can be disciplined above and beyond what the Code of Conduct already states where it can't. So I think some of the feedback or the commentary tonight is that the Code of Conduct has no teeth. I agree it's probably not enforced anywhere near as much as it should, but adding this localised policy isn't going to solve those problems. And I think, the policy in whole is not so bad, and I think the amendments are okay, but the one that did stick out or stand out to me in briefing and prior discussions was where it adds things like, we cannot make statements that discredit the Shire, and I think that goes a little bit too far. I understand that we shouldn't be calling the organisation into disrepute, but to say that a councillor can't effectively say anything that's perceived to be negative towards the Shire effectively means that we lose our role of accountability. So that I did take an issue with. So, I'm not suggesting this amendment or this motion is the perfect one, but it is addressing some of those concerns I've got with the original one. So if this motion doesn't get up, I'll assess any other motion on its merits, but I do agree with some of the intent behind the motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Marsh. Any speaker against the motion? I'll speak against the motion. I preface this by saying that I appreciate the time that officers, particularly in the governance team, have taken in assisting Councillor Gill with the wording that's put forward in this motion. And these comments are not a reflection on those officers or their contribution. The amendments are really poor. It's a badly structured amendment. For example, clause 5.1.5. Would remove that it says here in the motion, this point D, 5.1.5 relates to councillors and shire officers, so it proposes to remove councillors from that, which is all well and good, until it then starts to delete some of the sub-clauses. For example, in point E, it says remove the last dot point in its entirety, which would mean that comments or actions, e.g. liking a post or comment, that show councillor support of another post that seeks to do any of these things also wouldn't apply and therefore wouldn't apply to shire officers, which doesn't seem to make sense at all. It also seeks to amend 5.1, which is, and 5.1.2, which is clause C, you can see there in the motion. 5.1.2 is: the media shall be entitled to receive all information that is public information and expect that councillors and council officers will assist the media in presenting and explaining relevant information. That is a very pro-free speech and pro-transparency statement, and we are removing that from applying from councillors. So councillors shouldn't be assisting the media or shouldn't be providing information that's public? That doesn't make any sense. That's not a free speech argument whatsoever. This is a very poorly structured motion. There's been so much time to do this properly, to do this correctly. Many hours of briefings. It's been deferred once before and twice before, in fact, I think. Plenty of opportunity to get this right, and it's disappointing that it's come to us in this format tonight. So I won't be supporting this motion as it's worded. It doesn't make sense. There are many good things and bad things that I personally think should either be in the policy or not in the policy, but, you know, I can't support the motion as it's worded here because it's amending it in ways that, frankly, doesn't make sense to me. Thank you. Councillors, is there a speaker in favour of the motion? Any other speaker? Councillor Gill to close.
Thank you. And I hope no one takes this personally because... Oh, sorry, did you have the call?
I only had a little to say, but I did second the motion.
I've already moved to closing, Councillor Bissinger. Councillor Gill to close.
It is very disappointing that it comes in this format tonight, but it comes in this format because the Mayor wouldn't allow me to move the motion that I wanted to. It wasn't accepted that all references to the media conduct of councillors be deleted from the policy in the Local Government Act be referred to as the appropriate way to govern elected representatives' media involvement. That could have gone to officers, and we would have had a well-rounded motion coming from that with expertise, instead of one that was done at the last minute because my one was not allowed to be put to you. From a libertine, mind you, a libertine, someone who's
point of order. This is getting too personal.
Thank you, Councillor Chilley.
Point of order.
Relevance, I assume, or offensive? Or
I find it offensive. It's becoming a bit too personal.
Thank you, Councillor. What happens when we have a point of order is the clock gets stopped. I ask the Councillor who's raised the point of order what their point of order is, and if I can do that without interjections, that would be appreciated. Then I provide the ruling, and then we return, if we're in debate, we return back to debate. That would be the standard process. I'm going to rule in favour of your point of order, Councillor Chilley. Councillor Gill, if you could please return to debating the substantive motion as the closer of debate. In principle, you are not to introduce new items of debate, rather you are to close the debate. And if you could please do so, that would be appreciated.
And it should apply to all motions, of course. My point here, then, is not about whether someone has talked about free speech in the past. It's not about just those issues that control of this council and the way that we go about it. I don't believe it's well thought out to say that we need more controls and that we need controls over how we approach the media. We are elected representatives, the same as state and federal politicians, and we should be allowed to speak on topics no matter what. That's the main point, and I would have thought that some people would agree with that. I know that the points that the Mayor has just raised about how the format looks, but it wouldn't have been the format. It's not about how we treat each other either, because that's governed by the Code of Conduct. This is about control. How we restrict our own freedom of speech is not, as I said, not applied at any other level of government. Think about it. The way you're going to vote now has the consequence of limiting what we can do to represent our community. That's all it does. That's the purpose of controlling councillor media responses. That's all it can be. It's not about how we treat each other, because that's a different matter. That is the code of conduct, which has been pointed out, is a different matter. This is not that matter. This is purely, can a councillor go and talk to the media about their issues that they're representing the community on or not? Is there going to be someone come over the top, like some legal person who will say, you can't do that? That's banned from our within our media policy.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. Your time has elapsed. That concludes debate, and I'll put the matter to the vote. All those in favour? Against? Motion is carried. Councillors, we now proceed to item...
I'm not even calling a division.
Was that a division? Yes, please. Yes, okay. A division requested by Councillor O'Connor. All those in favour? Councillor Gill, Councillor Marsh, Councillor Bissinger, Councillor Roper, Councillor Maher, Councillor Brooks, and against? Councillor O'Connor, Councillor Dixon, Councillor Race, Councillor Chelly, Councillor Holland. The motion is carried. The division was requested by Councillor O'Connor. So, councillors, just to be clear, the media relations policy has been carried and is in effect. We now proceed to item 5.1, section 5, notices of motion. Notice of motion 408 from Councillor Gill, access to master plan studies and policies. Councillors, the motion is before us. I'm assuming, Councillor Gill, you're moving that still as worded.
Thank you.
And I'm seeking a seconder. Councillor Bissinger to second. Is there any opposition, or Councillor Gill, do you wish to speak?
If there's no opposition, I don't wish to speak.
You can open debate, Councillor Gill. Thank you.
The motion and the officer's comment of... most interesting. The officer's comment says that the Shire maintains a list of adopted master plan strategies and studies on the Shire website under the strategy and plan listing. I hope councillors have tried to look that up, because if you have, you might be in for a surprise. In addition, all council adopted policies are included on the website under policy listing. And a reconciliation of current policies, strategies and master plans will be undertaken to identify any additional documents that may need to be added to the website. The officers themselves are saying in that last sentence that they are going to check. They are going to look at a reconciliation of current policies, strategies and master plans, because I don't think people are sure whether they're all there. That's the only thing I can read there. And it's an endorsement that we need a list, and the main part that I'm suggesting is that we have some sort of general advice on finding the complete documents, because they are not necessarily easy to find. This is the lifeblood of what the council does. Policies, master plans, studies that are very costly, and officers enact those. That's the role of the officers, and our role is to look at the policies and the studies that we're doing on different areas. Most of the councillors have to wait, and maybe wait for years to get some of those things done, because they sometimes cost a lot of money, and then wait a lot more years sometimes for the money to be available to implement. We should be looking at those policies, those master plans, studies, all the time. That's our fundamental role of representing our community, is through those actions, through those matters. So if officers are not sure if they're all there, it's a small matter to make sure that they're all there and they're all available and the public can get to see them easily, and that's the intent of the motion. I don't think it's controversial, but that's why I'm doing it. Now, coming back to the officers, I think they do an incredible job in that area. This is not something where I'm criticising the officers. It's a matter of making sure that everything is encapsulated and is available, and that's a difficult role, difficult job to have, and it passes down from one officer to another over time, and it needs to be checked over time. So that's why I'm moving it. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. Councillor Bissinger, do you wish to speak?
Reserve the right if there's any other comments.
Any other councillor wishing to speak? No, in that case, Councillor Bissinger.
Through the Mayor, this is a very strange situation because I have approached officers through councillor requests, I think it was three times, to have a spreadsheet done so that you could see where the master plans are at. So a list of all the master plans, what stage they had been to, how long they'd been in operation, whether the final drafts had been done. Just a comprehensive spreadsheet that would be easy to reference. I had a couple of inquiries from residents who are far better at navigating the council's website than I am, and they couldn't find any kind of comprehensive list or anything like that. They had to look up each individual one, which was time-consuming and not always, they felt, accurate. So I just... given information that it was too big a job for anyone to undertake, and I just thought that was a little bit of a problem because I kept getting repeated requests for the same list of master plans. So hopefully if this brings about a list of master plans, a spreadsheet that shows you where they're at, what's happening, then I think it would be much better for everyone else because the amount of money that is spent on master plans is absolutely phenomenal and they just seem to go somewhere and die. And you sort of think, well, if they're there and we can keep an eye on them and say what they actually happen, where they actually go, what should be happening with them, then it's sort of, I think it's a really good thing to have. Just to have that information is very valuable to councillors. They know what's going on in their ward and also to just to residents in general so they can see where their rates are being spent and what's happening. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Bissinger. Any speaker against? Councillor Chelley.
Thank you. I want to know why we need to do this, NOM. I mean, if people can't find things on the website, I know they probably don't know where to look, don't know what they're looking for, and don't know where to find it.
Point of order,
Councillor Bissinger.
I spoke after no one else wanted to make any other comments as a right of reply.
Your point of order, Councillor Bissinger.
Pardon?
Your point of order, Councillor Bissinger.
No point of order, apparently. Thank you.
We'll return to debate. Restart the clock. Thank you.
I think this is an unnecessary NOM. We've got the officer comment in there that the Shire currently maintains a list of adopted master plan strategies and studies on the Shire website under strategy and plan listing. It's quite a comprehensive listing. I refer to that all the time and I have no problem finding information that I need for me or for the community. Also, all council adopted policies are included on the website under the policy listing. And the officers have actually put in there that a reconciliation of the current policies, strategies and master plans will be undertaken to identify any additional documents that may need to be added to the website. This is an ongoing process that officers continually undertake, and they do update councillors through the governance department. So I really can't understand why we have such unnecessary NOMs that actually come around this council table when officers and the organisation are already on to doing a lot of operational procedures. We just need to ask, and we need to ask for that information through the correct processes. I've had no problems getting information from the organisation or from officers. So while I understand the intent of this, I think I don't really want to waste my energy to support this NOM tonight. Thanks.
Thank you, Councillor Chelley. Is there a speaker in favour of the motion? Councillor Brooks.
Thank you, through the Mayor. I think basically the outcome's been achieved in that there is that officer comment saying that there will be a reconciliation. I'm in favour of it. I think it's good housekeeping, and the fact that the officers have agreed that this is a good idea just to do a check and an update, I think, is a great thing and good for the organisational side of things as well. I am in favour. I do understand Councillor Chelley's argument, but I think it's been recognised by the officers that this is good housekeeping. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Brooks. Is there a speaker against the motion? Any other speaker at all? Councillor Roper?
Thank you, through the Chair. I'm not really against this, or it appears the officers have already answered this one, but I would like to have added something about timelines. because we've already seen there's a lot of master plans out there and they kind of get lost in space and there's no timelines for completion. So this is one question we often get asked. What's happening to the master plan? We've got master plans. This was supposed to be done 2 years ago. What's happening with it? And it all comes down to funding. But I think we do need clarity so that the residents, community's expectations are realistic and they know what's happening with their master plans and where they're actually sitting. So I appreciate Councillor Gill's bringing this notice of motion, but it looks like the officers are on that track going to do that anyway. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Roper. Any other speaker on this motion? No? Councillor Gill to close debate.
I can see the swing with that sort of sentiment, but what would happen if I didn't bring a notice of motion or you didn't bring a notice of motion? That's debatable. But maybe a discussion may have achieved it, but then the public wouldn't know about it. This is an opportunity for the public to know that this will become available and hopefully more easily available, and that's the main sentiment here. How do we make accessibility for people who are interested in our policies and master plans? And usually people are not so interested until it's in their area and something that affects them. But as was pointed out very early on, if you're looking for one particular thing, it's hard to find. And try looking them up, but it's hard to find them. So somehow making it easier, making sure we've got them all, which I have spoken to an officer, the officer spoke to me, and that was great because that sorted out the issues. And any mention of a timeline for this, I discarded basically because I know what sort of work is involved and I don't want this to be the main work while other things are happening. This is something that can happen over a little longer period of time, so that's not an impost put a time limit of a couple of months on it and then that's all that someone can do. So I didn't want to have that happen. I believe that this is a necessary, it's something that needs publicity to tell people that they will be able to get access, easier access, and this is a simple way of doing that. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. That concludes debate and I'll put the matter to the vote. All those in favour? Against? Carried. Thank you, councillors. We now move to item 5.2, Notice of Motion 409 from Councillor Gill, Port Industrial Land for Residential Purposes.
And I just want to inform the Mayor and councillors that I accept the potential alternative wording of officers.
Councillors, the motion as moved by Councillor Gill will be as highlighted in the red text there. So I'll take that as moved by Councillor Gill. That's the officer's alternate wording. I'm seeking a seconder. Councillor Brooks. Oh, sorry, Councillor Dixon. Did you want to second that? Councillor Dixon. There we go. Councillor Gill to open debate.
Thank you. This is a continuation of earlier discussion, but it's particularly aimed at the port-related zoned land, and I'm pleased that Councillor Dixon is the person seconding, because she's most, between two areas probably, the Watson Ward and the Hastings Cerberus Ward, are most affected. We're all affected in the sense that if we want alternative industrial growth and we've run out of industrial land and we need this land desperately, I think, then we need to look at the residential aspect of it as well. That doesn't mean we go helter-skelter and start destroying the landscape. What it means is that we investigate, we find out what's available, where it would be best sited as part of any further industrial usage on the peninsula. It seems that we just have to keep chipping away at these issues to make sure that if we got and we're getting it anyway, in some major industrial development at the port, which will mean that people will have to travel a long way because they're not going to afford probably not being able to afford rental, even if it was available, or buy houses, and that's also in short supply. So looking at this is just forward thinking, simple as that. Finding out what we can do, getting the government to actually look at these, I think, quite simple matters. The need is obvious. The how to do it, most of the land is owned privately, or a lot of it's owned privately, and encouraging people to provide through rezoning of land where we want it, where it should be in this area. So I'll close it off there, but I think it's just a quite simple advocacy piece. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. Councillor Dixon, did you wish to speak as the seconder?
Thank you, Mayor, and thank you, Councillor Gill. Yes, I very much look forward to this going forward too, and I think we discussed recently in a recent meeting about a port precinct plan to overlook the entire area, and I think that's really important. And so that's something I look forward to the government coming back with and helping us and assisting people who own various sections of land, whether it be private, state, whatever. And the fact that the surplus land that has been suggested is not needed to actually activate that. So I think if we can all work together and come to a good outcome, it will benefit our community in the longer term. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Dixon. Any councillor wishing to speak against? Any councillor wishing to speak at all? Councillor Race?
Look, I just wanted to kind of highlight that next week we'll be up at Queen's Hall, I believe, and this will be a part of our advocacy because the Port of Hastings and unlocking that the extra land is a big point of our advocacy this year. So this will tie in nicely at that. So next week, community, have no doubt that your councillors will be advocating strongly for this because it is important to us. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Race. Councillor Roper.
Thank you, through the Chair. Yeah, this is one we've been working on for a long time. That land's been sitting there for 60-odd years, there are a lot of it's privately owned and is already being used for agriculture and other purposes. But the more we can advocate, and there's a lot of spare land there, and we need housing and all sorts of different styles of properties there, lifestyle, low density. So anything we can do to lobby and advocate to the state government to change that zoning is great for us, I think.
Thank you, Councillor Roper. Any other councillor wishing to speak? No, there were no speakers against. Councillor Gill, did you wish to close? You would like to speak? Hand up nice and high. Thanks, Councillor Brooks.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You were just looking in the wrong direction and I was a little bit hesitant. My apologies, Councillor Dixon, for being overly enthusiastic. I think this is a terrific opportunity to really push this and I'm highly supportive. One of the things that we've all been in discussion with our planning officers in recent times is C219 and this requirement by state government that we accept another 24,000 odd dwellings over the next few years. We know the challenges with a very limited urban growth boundary or constrained urban growth boundary, particularly on the Port Phillip side. And we at the same time, we recognise the fact that the Western Port side of the peninsula needs a big uplift and support, and that there seems to be this moment in time where there is a focus on Western Port now for new industry, and obviously we've done some of the initial work for industrial land strategy, as Councillor Gill mentioned. So there seems to be a good moment in time to push this as being a series of solutions that state government could work with us on. Thank you, Siri. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Brooks. Any other councillor wishing to speak? Speak now, forever hold your peace. Councillor Gill to close. Thank you. Thank you, Councillor Gill. That concludes debate, and I'll put the matter to the vote. All those in favour? Against? Motion carried. Councillors, we now proceed to section 6 of our agenda, urgent business. Is there any urgent business? Councillor Marsh.
Thanks, Councillor Holland. I circulated one earlier today, which after discussion with a few councillors this evening, I've adjusted a little bit, and I'm not suggesting it will get up tonight, but I did want to take the opportunity to at least raise it and discuss it. So it's up on the board. Basically, you can see the amendment from what was circulated earlier is that it calls for a report in a month's time as opposed to commits us to anything today.
Sorry, is this different to what you...
Yeah, so that's the correct wording on there now. The amendment...
Right, that's okay. So I'll call a 5 or 10 minute break and give time councillors time to assess this. So we'll come back at 9:15. Thank you, councillors. Thank you, councillors, officers, members in the gallery and those streaming online from home. We'll resume the meeting at 9:15 p.m. Councillors, we have before us wording for urgent business. Of course, there are two motions that take place for each item of urgent business that is considered. The first is that we allow the urgent business to be heard. That can be debated, and of course, we are only debating the urgency of the matter. If you are wondering... what you wish to debate, you need to look at section 9 of the governance rules on page 8. There are two clauses, clause 1 and clause 2. That is what is being debated, not the substance of the motion in front of us, but whether or not it's urgent and whether or not it's valid to be put as an urgent motion. Councillor Mars, I assume you're moving that we put the urgent business. Is there a seconder? Councillor Gill? Is there any objection? Councillor Marsh to open debate.
Thanks, Mayor Holland. These ones are always tricky because obviously I've got to confine it to the urgency. I guess the urgency is that there's a big elevated, illuminated elephant in the street in Mornington that everyone has seen pop up and has surprised a lot of people. And there's applications coming through for more of them. And every day that we delay means that we're not doing work to close that loophole if there is in fact a loophole. So this motion is to explore whether we should at least start some work to address these issues. And the community have been banging on our doors ever since it has gone up. And if you haven't seen the photo, it's a bit of a, I would say it's a disaster for the area in terms of character. And if you haven't seen it, I'll drive and have a look. But I think it's urgent in the fact that we just need to get on with it. And every day that we waste not exploring what we can do in response to this application that has gone through the keeper, you know, it's just a day that we might have a few more applications get through. Thanks.
Thank you, Councillor Marsh. Councillor Gill is the seconder.
Yeah, thank you. This is an interesting urgent one because it's asking for a report which puts it in a different category that I haven't seen before. What it's saying is it's urgent because we don't have a response planned, and the sooner we get that started to get a response before more of these type of planning applications come in, the better. So in that sense, it is urgent. And I remind councillors that urgent business is business that's voted on to be urgent. That's the real criteria. So if we feel that this planning matter is needed to be got on with quickly and a report being brought, then I would urge people to vote that it is urgent business.
Thank you, Councillor Gill. Is there a speaker against? Councillor Chelly.
Thank you. If we're voting on the first instance of whether this constitutes urgent business, I believe that it doesn't go past the first goalpost as meeting the criteria of urgent business in accordance with our governance rules. This isn't a new matter that's arisen since the distribution of the agenda, and it isn't an item that cannot be reasonably listed on the agenda at the next meeting or the next council meeting where we can have a full report investigating this issue that can give us all the information, not to mention that it's a bit ambiguous and it doesn't answer point two of the governance rules, which is we don't know whether it substantially affects the level of the council service. It may or it may not, but I do know that in a response given earlier today that additional resource would need to be relocated to deal with this matter, and therefore I believe it would interfere with current council service at the operations level. So I don't believe that this actually passes the first goalpost as constituting urgent business for us to look at tonight, and would prefer a report or a notice motion where we can get more information to make an informed decision. And also it doesn't really fix the immediate concern, which is about the signage. The signage is already up. Why wasn't the application called in around the council meeting? If anything, the urgent business should have called in the application for it to be reassessed or something done with this particular case of the signage that has gone up. Doing a strategy, waiting for a strategy is not going to fix the issue of this signage and all future signages, which still have a right to apply under the scheme. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Chelly. Is there a speaker in favour of the motion? Any other speaker against? No. Councillor Marsh to close.
Thanks, Mayor Holland. I think the last speech, I guess, sort of ignores the change since this motion was initially circulated. I think often we don't do compromise well, and that's exactly what I've tried to do with this slight tweak in the wording since it was circulated, and the fact that it is calling for a report so we can explore all of those issues without committing to anything. If we did this via a notice of motion, we'll end up in the same point. We'll just be many weeks down the road, and officers will have less time to consider if they were to do it within a shorter time frame. For example, I could call a NOM at the next meeting to say to bring this to the following meeting 2 weeks later. It would still end up at the same meeting. They'll just have half the amount of time to prepare it. So I think it's all good and well to attack the mechanism to get it here, but this is a mechanism available to us as councillors, and I do think it is urgent. And I think if you go and speak to the residents of Mornington or anyone that drives past, they'll tell you it's urgent. And if we stop one more billboard getting through, I think that would still be time worthwhile. So again, The motion isn't calling for what was suggested earlier. It's simply calling for a report. And that could be a one-pager. I don't mind, but it's to explore the options, and therefore I think it's urgent.
Thank you, Councillor Marsh. That concludes debate. I'll put the matter to the vote. All those in favour? Against? The motion is lost.
By division. Thanks, Mayor.
A division requested by Councillor Marsh. All those in favour to allow the item to be put? Please stand. Councillor Gill, Councillor O'Connor, Councillor Marsh, Councillor Dixon, Councillor Bissinger. All those against? Councillor Race, Councillor Roper, Councillor Maher, Councillor Brooks, Councillor Chelly, Councillor Holland. The motion is lost, which means the item will not allow to be put. Councillors, is there any other urgent business? No, in that case, we proceed to section 7 of our agenda tonight, confidential items, of which there are none. Councillors, that concludes our agenda this evening. Thank you for your attendance. Thank you to the council officers in preparing our agenda and the reports this evening. And thank you, as always, to RPPFM for video production. We'll see you at our next council meeting. Have a good evening.